convention, Tampa, Florida, we have former keynote speaker from Melbourne, Australia, 2012, founder of the Natural Lifestyles, professional vagabond, wise man, and one of the most amazing dudes that I have known, and guys that, you know, one of the most popular guys on the YouTube channel. We have James Marshall coming up here to tell us, man, everything about life. Awesome, man.
Thank you. It is a pleasure and an honor to once again be speaking at the one and only 21 convention. Special thanks to MC Maeda, to Grand Architect Anthony Paul Johnson up the back, to his lovely wife Mary Lee, to Mike, and to everyone else that makes this very unique conference possible. I am James Marshall, and today I would like to discuss with you a big idea. The title of my speech is How to Be a Man. I get asked this all the time as a mentor for men. Guys are constantly writing to me and saying, dude, how do I be a man? Yeah, how do I deal with women? How do I deal with life? What am I supposed to be? And I thought, well, I can cover that pretty simply. I just wrote down a few things here. Should be able to do this in about 60 seconds. So here's the answer. You ready? Play sport, be a team player, shoot guns, learn MMA, drink beer, drink whiskey, wear a suit. Study hard, work hard, play hard, stay hard for at least 45 minutes. Drive a big car, make money, and fuck bitches. Don't be a pussy, man up, suck it up, cheer up, keep it up. Join the army, choose a job, choose a career, choose a family, choose a big fucking television, and most of all, no poofters. There you go. Got it? Masculinity today in the 21st century is in crisis. Men are very unclear about what their role is, who they're supposed to be, how they're supposed to go about initiating themselves or being initiated from boyhood into manhood. And I want to talk to you guys today about why that is, some of the causes of that, how that affects you, and what it is that you can do to become a man. Some years ago, I was speaking at a conference similar to this. Not the same, it was a bit creepy and weird actually, but similar, it was a men's dating conference. And after my presentation, a young man came up to me and he said, James, thanks for your speech. It really resonated with me. It helped me. And using my special staring technique and qualifying technique, I said, why did it help you? And he said, well, like you, I was brought up in a single parent household by a single mother, and I didn't have a dad around. And as you know, in the 60s, feminism happened, and men's rights were squashed, and men had their testicles cut off and essentially oppressed by women, and now they're pussies and they don't know what to do with themselves. This guy, in a nutshell, was describing in his mind the situation of masculinity today. That due to social movements, socio-political movements that happened last century, that the role of men has been flipped on its head, that now women are in control. Women are the ones wearing the pants. And in all areas of life, the judiciary, education, sexuality, the bringing up of kids, women are now the ones that are in control. And he was speaking about and alluding to a movement which has arisen in recent years, which is about taking back that power, standing up for men's rights against the insidious power of feminazis, women out there who are crushing masculinity and men's rights. Right?
Yeah.
No, wrong. I don't think so. I think that this belief that this young man had was misguided and incorrect and was certainly not doing him any justice. And I sat down with him and I discussed some alternatives to this. And I said, dude, do you know what a feminist actually is? Do you know what feminism is?
Marxism.
I don't really want to hear your opinion right now, thank you. And he then said basically what a lot of people would say when asked today what a feminist is. You ask the average person on the street and they'll say, ugly, fat, lesbian hates men. Or something to do with getting the vote, and now they've gone too far. Yeah, it's like vote gone too far, which means that now if a man looks sideways at a woman, he's going to be accused of harassment. If he has sex with her, then he's likely that he's going to be accused of rape. If he has children with her, then he's going to have his kids ripped off her and his property taken away from her. This is a very simplistic explanation for very complex situations. And in my opinion, it's something that is not going to benefit men who are confused about their masculinity. You may be starting to think, why is James Marshall talking about feminism at a men's conference? And I asked myself this for the last year as I've been considering this speech, because there are a whole lot of areas that I can stand up here and rant about in my sleep that guys will find very interesting about sexuality and seduction and lifestyle design, and will be more important to me in terms of business return. But I decided that this was an important topic to talk about. Men's rights, feminism, how those things interact, and how they're going to affect you. Because in my mind, if you start to unplug from an ideology and then plug into another one, you need to be really careful about what that ideology does to you. The point of this conference and the point of the men's movement that we're involved in is that we are starting to question the status quo. Yeah, we're questioning our parents' morality. We're questioning a society that says that we must do what? All that stuff on that list in order to be a man. That we must go to school, get a good job, work ourselves to an early grave, must marry the first woman we have sex with, must breed, must vote and act and operate in exactly the same manner as our demographic or our parents have prescribed to us. And for the guys who are involved in this kind of movement, they're starting to question that and go, well, actually, why should I do that? And does that benefit me? Were those structures built for my benefit, or were they built in a way that means that I am actually a slave, that I don't have choice, and that I don't get the best out of my life? If you've come into this movement, you've started to question things like, well, being a nice guy and being helpful and accommodating and giving and buying chicks stuff and opening doors and trying to take them on 3 dates and not touching them and all that gentlemanly stuff, which has nothing to do with feminism, that's to do with old school chivalry, that's to do with repressive norms based on religion. And when you've tried that enough and you recognise that that doesn't seem to work, does it? Yeah, when we all try that at some point, then you question that and you go, all right, well, what else is there? How else can I operate in my dating and seduction life? And that's where you come to conferences like this or start to listen to speakers who've got alternative views. And once you start to unplug from one set of assumptions, inevitably you start to question other ones, which is why this conference is not just about seduction. It's about health, it's about lifestyle, it's about finance. It's about being an autonomous man who gets to make choices in his life, not being a victim, not being a victim to a structure that was implanted upon you from birth. I'm not a scholar of gender. This is not my area of expertise, but I think it's important that I now give you a really brief history of feminism, because a lot of guys out there are really confused about or have made assumptions about what this means and have designated the enemy as women, particularly women who stand up for their own rights, yeah, in terms of losing power. And I want you to actually start to question that idea and think about, where did you get that idea from? How much research did you put into it? Because that's not the truth. Feminism, in a nutshell, has been the pursuit of equality between gender. That has always been its overall goal. Because throughout history, women have been second class. Women have been downtrodden, women have been controlled, women have been violently oppressed throughout almost all societies, except if we look very far back into history, into hunter-gatherer societies, often they were more egalitarian. But once we saw property arise, power arise, armies arise in civilizations, then repression of women became the norm. And feminism is always looking to deconstruct and to criticize the patriarchy. Patriarchy is something which is an unnatural power structure. It is something that has been created by men for men's benefit. And as feminists would say, patriarchy doesn't just hurt women, it hurts men. Because the patriarchal system is governed by people at the very top who get to dictate what it means to be a man or what it means to be a woman. masculinity and femininity become institutionalized rather than being allowed to exist on a spectrum, which is where it truly does. Because within all of us, we have these aspects of feminine and masculine. But in old school masculinity, in the patriarchal conception of what it means to be a man, there's very little variation and very little choice. You have to be a certain way because it's perceived that the nature of man and woman is essential, that it is timeless, that it is set in stone, that it's biological, and that there's no point in fighting it because that's the way things actually are. Feminism was starting to question those assumptions about, is that really true? Are women always passive caregivers whose only role is to look after the family and essentially be the servant of their man? Or is there more to women than that? So, loosely speaking, feminism is divided into three epochs or eras where women and the men who supported them were looking to right or to equalize certain imbalances that were clearly existing. So the first wave of feminism happened in the late 19th century, early 20th century, and it was about democratic voting rights. Because in this country and every other country where there was democracy, democracy was not for everybody. It was for rich white men, pretty much. That's what it was for. It was not for black people. It was not for women. And so, of course, it wasn't actually democracy, was it? It was just funneling power up into a small group of people. And so women of that time stood up and said, well, actually, we should be able to vote in this democratic process. We should be able to engage and decide who actually governs us. And the assumption was at that time, which was across the board, was that women were not as intelligent as men, that they were not as rational as men, that they couldn't really be trusted to make decisions about who was in power, because if they had their period, they might vote for the wrong person. Yeah? And this was believed by all people. And the first wave was questioning that, and the women of that time fought hard for the rights to be able to actually vote and also to be able to have some rights in terms of property. Because prior to that time, women didn't really have any rights. They were essentially the property of their men and therefore under control and at the whims of whatever it was that they deemed to be their rightful place. The second wave of feminism happened in the 60s, and this is the one that the original protagonist from my story was referring to. 60s happened, bra burning, lesbians hate men, and equals testicles cut off men somewhere along the line. The feminism of the 1960s did not happen in a vacuum. It was not just this random thing that occurred out of nowhere. Because in the 60s, particularly in this country, there was a whole lot of people standing up and questioning all sorts of traditions and rules that had been in place for generations, if not centuries. Alongside the feminist movement was the civil rights movement, which was, again, standing up for the rights of people who, based on the colour of their skin, were not allowed to be involved in the democratic process, who didn't have the same rights as white people. You also had a counterculture movement, which was questioning all of the morality of their parents. Yeah, where guys started to grow their hair long, get high, and listen to the Doors, and learn how to dance and express their feelings. Yeah, because prior to that, that was not fucking done, was it? If you were a man, you had short hair and you were tough. Yeah, you didn't dance in the fields with long hair. Alongside this was happening the sexual revolution. Yeah, where prior to that, sex was sinful, wrong, and legislated against, except in the very small confines of a married couple. Anything outside of that was wrong and often illegal. Sex was not experienced for joy, for experimentation, for connection. And the young people of that time started to go, well, screw that. Yeah, we're going to go out and explore our sexuality because it's pleasurable. And in that time, the feminist movement was huge in terms of deconstructing sexuality and looking at the fact that women were sexual beings, that sex was not just for reproduction for them, that they had desires outside of the home. And alongside that, you had access to simple, cheap contraception. The advent of the contraceptive pill meant that for the first time in history, women could separate their sexuality and reproduction, which meant that they gained control over their reproductive rights. They could choose not to have kids and still have sex. Yeah? And alongside that came rights for abortion, which is a very touchy topic today. But abortion always happened, whether it was legal or not. It just happened very dangerously and women died from it. And when it was legalized, again, this allowed women to take control over their fertility, which is a very terrifying thing to the patriarchy because it starts to deconstruct control over women. When a woman gets to decide who she has sex with and why, that's a terrifying thing to men who can't handle women who are not controlled. But from that era, completely the opposite of having your testicles cut off and being repressed, that allowed people to started to explore a spectrum of masculinity and femininity, to start to explore sexuality in very different ways than had ever been accepted. People stood up and questioned their government and said, why is it that we've sent 50,000 of our young men over to some Southeast Asian country to massacre peasants? Yeah, is that a just war? Because prior to that, you didn't question warfare. That your government or your king decided was just because they had divine right or because they were, you know, their ideology was correct. You just ran over the trenches at the machine guns. Yeah? For God and king and country or whatever nonsense it was that they'd convinced you was worth dying for. That era was really special in America, in Australia, in Europe, or in many places around the world where people started to really question the status quo. And feminism was a vital force in that. Third wave feminism, which is from the 90s until today, is looking at a more kind of postmodern and decentralized view of gender relations. Because the first and second wave was initiated and campaigned by and for white, generally middle class, upper class, educated women. These are women who had some resources behind them, who had some education, who were able to stand up, and so it tended to be Eurocentric or Anglocentric. And so the new wave of feminism, which is happening today, is still not about, and never has been about, man-hating, bra-burning, and, you know, being a lesbian. It's about looking at micropolitics around the world of women's rights, women's issues. The fact that still in Africa, lots of young girls get their clitorises cut off. The fact that there's more sexual slavery, or more slavery happening today than there ever was. Even in the height of the slave trade in America. Women are sold into sexual slavery. Women are still traded and bought and sold as cattle, more or less, in many places around the world. The feminist revolution in terms of allowing genders to be equal is nowhere nearly finished, and it certainly hasn't gone too far. There's been a reactionary movement which has grown since the 80s, the manosphere, the men's rights movement. And these are loose organizations of men who perceive that there are gross injustices systematically against men in the Western world. There are a lot of very hot topics within this, particularly in terms of things such as custody, rights to children, and These are areas that certainly, in some areas, need to be addressed, in that often women are given custody of children because they're perceived to be the primary caregivers. That's not a feminist idea. That's an old, archaic idea about what women's roles are actually. If we're talking about gender bias, it's actually based in old school thinking. Modern feminist or equality-based thinking would perceive that men and women should be able to raise children with the same level of care. There shouldn't be a gender bias against it, but it's not the fault of the feminists that that kind of thing exists. Men's rights advocates bang on constantly about false rape allegations, false sexual harassment allegations. It's interesting because I personally train men to harass women all over the world. That's my job. Yeah, I take groups of men in 20-something countries, I teach them some good harassment techniques, And then we run down the streets and we approach women in cafes and bars and bookshops and all over the fucking place and harass the shit out of them. We run up there and we go, hey, you, I think you're pretty. What's your name? And she's like, oh, he's harassing me. Oh, that's kind of cool. And that's what I do. And in my personal life and in the students, the thousands of students that I've taught, not one of us has ever been accused taken to court for our harassment. Not one of us has been falsely accused of rape, although I'm personally responsible for hundreds of people having sex. And every time a student has sex, I kind of count that as one of mine as well. So I've had sex with thousands of chicks. But seriously, rape is not a funny issue. And according to the men's rights sphere, most of the time there is no rape. It's mostly false rape allegations. There have been studies done by the FBI that look at false allegations of any kind, and there is no more evidence to suggest that any more false allegations have happened with rape than murder or anything else. It's around 2%, something like that. Women don't generally allege rape against men for fun, because it's not a fun process to have to stand up in court and talk about a traumatic event, a very, very personal event. And unfortunately, most women don't report these situations. I am very close to a lot of women, friends, lovers, and people confide in me because I don't judge them, because how can I possibly judge them? I'm the biggest slut of them all, yeah? And from my anecdotal research, the instances of women experiencing sexual violence are massive. They're very high. And for guys who don't actually communicate in detail with women, who are not very intimate with the women, they won't see this. They'll perceive that, oh yeah, well, it's, does it really happen? And if it does, well, did she kind of deserve it? Because of the, on account of the old skirt she was wearing or the fact she had a drink or whatever other bullshit people use to justify that kind of behavior. The issues that women have faced in the past, they still face today. But in the Western world, they certainly do have a lot more freedom and a lot more autonomy than they ever did, which is fucking awesome. Particularly for pickup artists and seducers. Interestingly enough, pickup artists and feminists are unlikely allies. Ideologically, we're not very different. Because I personally believe in being able to have relationships based solely on the fact that we're attracted to each other. I believe that I shouldn't have to pay for a woman in any way, shape, or form. Unless I feel like buying a dinner or feel like buying a coffee, I shouldn't have to do that. And the few women that I know that would stand up and say that they are actually feminists, because I've talked about this in the past, that the worst thing you can call a man, the worst insult you can call a man is a loser. Yeah, which is based on a very old concept of what a man has to be. He has to be competitive, he has to win, he has to be, he has to have massive resources behind him. He needs to command the respect and the fear of other men, and if he doesn't, he's a loser. He's out of the game, doesn't count. It's the worst thing you can call a man, really. And I said previously, the worst thing you can call a woman is a slut. And again, this is based on very old school thinking, which is that a woman's value is based on when and how and under what circumstances she decides to have sex with somebody. Not on her character or her heart or her achievements, but on did she fuck him and how long did she make him wait. Yeah? But I think I'd kind of update this now, because most women, I think, would be more worried about being labeled a feminist than they would being a slut. Because it's completely out of fashion. Contrary to the manosphere's perceptions that this feminazi elite is running the world, it has been something that was totally hijacked and bastardized in the 80s with neoconservative backlash and with the hijacking of those ideals of the 60s and 70s into consumer culture. There was an article written a few years ago which was about odd couples, people who's had different ideologies and still seem to get along. So they had a Catholic priest and a Jewish atheist, and they used to be buddies, and a greenie and a logger. And then there was me, the misogynist pickup artist, and one of my closest friends who's a feminist, calls herself a feminist. The article was, how do those two get along? Very well, thank you very much. And I thought that when this article came out, I'd get some kind of backlash, some kind of criticism. Yeah, from my, I don't know, old school liberal university friends or women or something. And I didn't. I didn't get any criticism. It's interesting. I've been a pickup artist publicly for 8 years, and I've never received any kind of criticism, any kind of attack from feminazis, feminists, women, at all. Only support. Because women perceive that what we're actually doing here is teaching men to be honest, to be clear, and to actually operate from a point of equality. Vagina equals penis. Trade, fair trade. I'm not trying to buy you, I'm not trying to impress you. I'm not trying to trick you into marriage. I like you, you like me. That's what we're trying to promote. And any woman who's got any brains will see if that's a good thing. I want more of those guys in the world. But the funny thing was that when my friend went into work, the women in her workplace, several of them went, oh, I didn't realize you were a feminist. I better hide the lipstick from you. Because the perception is that feminism equals not feminine. But as I was about to say, the several women that I know who would stand up and say they are feminists are in no way unfeminine. They're very sexy, they're very sensual. They love men, they have relationships with men. They're not anti-men, they're anti-inequality. And these are the kinds of girls that you definitely want to date, because they're women who go about their lives from a place of autonomy and independence. They earn their own money, they study, they find their own place in the world, and then when they choose to engage with a man on a sexual basis, it's not because they're looking for a provider or for somebody to save them or to become a princess. It's because they want to be with that guy. There is no conflict of interests in this kind of thing. There's definitely conflict of interests with people, conservative worldviews that perceive that women should be controlled and dominated by men, that should be institutionalized, when absolutely it shouldn't. Now, the main reason that I bring this whole topic up is because I know that a lot of guys out there who are experimenting with all of these new ideologies and methodologies and concepts will come in contact with the manosphere. It's become pretty big. There are a lot of guys writing vitriolic, nasty, anti-women, anti-feminist, anti-feminine blogs and Facebook groups and whatever out there. And as you're starting to unplug from the matrix, as I talked about earlier, you're going to start to come in contact with these ideas. Now, I certainly encourage you to be discerning and to check out new ideas. That's the whole point of what we're doing here, questioning old beliefs and checking out new ones. But I always encourage guys to think about what is it that's effective for you? Because you can either have a really strongly held belief or you can have flexibility and change. That's why I'm actually anti all ideology. I don't think that there is a single ideology on this planet which allows for the vast spectrum of human experience that's out there. There's not one answer for everybody out there. There are certainly different concepts and ways of living that you can experiment with, but if you believe that something has to be one solid, specific, and unmovable way, then you immediately destroy all other possibilities in your mind. And if that ideology doesn't allow you to connect with people and is destructive and violent and hateful, then it's stealing your life. It's a really interesting thing to research, I think, the concepts of memetics, which looks at the way that ideas and ideologies infect your brain. They bounce from brain to brain, and that's what I'm doing now, trying to infect you a little bit. And if they're really very strong and rigid, they can take a person over and to the point where they just can't, they're blind and they can't see anything else. And you see that with extremists of all types. Once they believe something that is so solid and they are so right, then everyone else is wrong. And once everyone else is wrong, you can justify doing anything to them, can't you? I've always called myself a Buddhist because one of the main things I really love about Buddhism is it doesn't have a prescribed morality code. It doesn't say, thou shalt not. It says, there are actions that are skillful and there are actions that are unskillful. Thoughts, feelings, and actions that are skillful and others that are not so skillful. And you're welcome to try them all. and you'll reap the benefits and the rewards and the price of each one of those. So for the guys out there who want to have an exceptional life, who want to have a vibrant sexual life, you want to start looking at what are skillful actions, what are skillful thought processes, and what are not. Because within the manosphere, the men's rights movement, there is a lot of hatred, bitterness, recrimination, and victimhood that is being espoused. Guys are blaming their problems on the feminist bogeyman. And it's very easy to blame feminists. Yeah? If we look at what has actually caused the crisis in masculinity, let's look at another narrative. So our original speaker, the original story dude in the beginning, told us that it was feminism that caused it. I've got an alternative narrative for you. And I'm not saying that this is necessarily the truth either, because any historical narrative is far more complex than just one story. But let's look at this, and this was my experience. Coming into the new generation, the baby boomer generation, into the, you know, the 60s and 70s generation, our parents still tended to get married pretty early. By the time my dad was 23, he had me. And I'm 35 now, and I'm like, Jesus, I still couldn't deal with one of these. Yeah. I don't know how you do it, Steve. Married very young, having kids, and suddenly you have a situation where divorce is possible. Because prior to 1960s divorce laws, you couldn't have no-fault divorce. You couldn't just get divorced because you were like, you know what, I'm fucking sick of this. I don't like you. Yeah? Or I want to go out and, you know, join the monastery or something. Couldn't do that, really. You had to prove that there was some major fault in the relationship through abuse or neglect or something for a court to be able to nullify it. That changed so that people could just get divorced because they wanted to get divorced. And for the first time, really, massive amounts of men could just leave. Yeah, they could go, you know what? I just want to grow a beard and ride a motorcycle through India. And many of them did. Or just they just fucked off, which is what my dad did. Most of my male friends growing up were in a similar situation. And huge numbers of my clients, when I'm just, one of the first things I'll say is, what's your relationship like with your dad? And they're like, one of the guys said, well, it's like my daddy always used to tell me. Yeah, exactly. Right? So you have a situation where a generation or half a generation of men are growing up without a clear father figure or male role model in the home. And as a result, there's a whole lot of single parent mothers who are not necessarily feminists, just women trying to do the best they can bringing up kids, trying to play the role of mother and father in the absence of a father figure. To me, that seems a more likely explanation for why we have a generation of men who are kind of lost. And also because there has been deconstruction of what societies mean. Because a century ago, wherever you lived in the world, it was very, very clear what it meant to be a man. It was very clear. You had one choice, which was that if your daddy was a blacksmith, you're a blacksmith. If you're an aristocrat, you're an aristocrat. If you're a slave, you're a slave. If you're of this religion, you stayed of that religion. You went through whatever initiation processes that were prescribed in that society in order to go from boyhood into manhood, and it was very clear what you were supposed to be. And I guess that was pretty good if you were happy with that one choice. But if you happen to have any inkling of a desire to be anything other than that, it wasn't so good. Because if you stepped out of line, you're an outcast, you're a queer, you're a faggot, you're a communist, whatever people needed to accuse you of, because you stepped out of line of what this narrow model of masculinity had prescribed to you. That was the power of the patriarchy. Keep everyone in place, do your job, go to war, die when told to, don't question, and be a fucking man. Man up, don't be a pussy, or whatever, you know, one-liners are thrown at men to just like keep them in their place and go, but I've got emotions, I want to express myself, I don't really want to do that thing. Man up, be a fucking man. Yeah? I'm actually really grateful for the fact that my dad wasn't around when I was growing up. Not that I don't have a father, I do, I love him, but he wasn't there as my primary influence in terms of masculinity. A lot of guys who are on these internet forums are whinging about the fact that they don't have a masculine presence and they're not respected, and you know, they're lost and they're frustrated, and it's the women's fault, and I'm gonna go and jack off to execution videos, whatever. That's a sick thought, isn't it? Jesus, where did I get that from? But for me, growing up in a single-parent poor household with actually a card-carrying feminist, I'm the poster boy of what the MRAs would say is, you know, why men are fucked. I was brought up by a woman who was definitely a feminist, who taught me how to iron my shirt, which is good because it meant I could do this and I didn't have to have a wife this morning. She taught me how to cook, which is also good because then I can invite women over and seduce them with my cooking skills. And she made it very clear to me that it was a good idea to treat women with respect and to demand respect from them in return. Not to be their doormat, not to be their Prince Charming who was trying to do everything for them, but just to expect that there would be an equal exchange. That was the basis of my ideology. But there was certainly a piece missing in terms of masculinity. I didn't know what the fuck it meant to be a man. I didn't know how to go about that. I was a weird kid who played the flute and was interested in drama, yeah, in a very rough, sporty school in Australia. Well, that was not fucking okay. That was what poofters did, which is gay, by the way. And when I stepped out of the prescribed model of masculinity, I was punished. I had the shit beaten out of me by tough kids at school because they didn't like my variations on masculinity. But I am grateful for that, because what it meant is it set me on a journey to choose my own masculine archetype. You can either decide that not having clear masculine role models means that you're a victim, means that you are hard done by, or you can decide that that's an awesome opportunity to choose. And that's what I did. I went out and I found mentors through my martial arts teachers, through artists, through writers and thinkers, through other contemporary men of my age who were trying to figure out as well, bouncing ideas off the women that we came across along the way. And so as a result, my own personal masculinity evolved and grew and, you know, came into fruition to the point where today I do feel very comfortable with myself. I don't know how to tell you guys how to be a man, but I certainly know how to be me pretty well right now, and to show other guys how to step out on a path to self-discovery and autonomy. And that comes firstly and foremostly by not being a victim, by not blaming external circumstances for your situation. It's not about manning up and being tough, it's about taking responsibility for the fact that we live in a deconstructed, chaotic, intensely mad world. And yes, it's confusing, but it's also exciting. It also provides us with opportunities to grow and to change and to experiment with all sorts of things that we never were allowed to experiment with under the old archaic ideas of what a man and a woman must be. And along the way, we get to experiment and play and share time with women who are going through that journey as well. Because there is nothing more beautiful than being with a woman who has chosen to be with you. Yeah? Of being with a woman who submits to you because she wants to, not because she has to. And there's nothing more amazing than seeing what a woman can be when she is taken out of the box and not controlled. Because as we've seen, there is so much more to her than just being a domestic slave. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with being a mother or a caregiver or choosing to take on that role, as long as it is a role that is chosen. When it's forced on, if any role is forced on people, and you guys have all experienced that. If you've been a nerdy kid, if you've been a guy who's been brutalized at school, if you've been bullied, if you've been teased because of your race, because of your height, because of any interest you had that was outside being a fucking lax bro or being a footy head or whatever, you know, very brutal and limited conception of what masculinity is, you've been punished for it. And so have women who've stepped out of line. And my role is to stand up in front of men and say, fuck that, do whatever the fuck you want to. Go and try out all sorts of different things. Experiment and understand that your masculinity is your own, is your choice. Because what makes a man really sexy, really powerful, is a man who is at ease with himself. It's not all of those, you know, buzzwords and, you know, really simplistic conceptions of what masculinity is. It's a man who's cool with himself. Yeah? The reason women like me really is that I'm just okay with myself now. And that took me a decade or more of not being okay with myself and being confused and living in existential crisis and testing and trialing and all this stuff along the way to the point where, yeah, okay, cool, I know myself now. I'm okay with myself. And women go, cool, it's a guy who's okay with himself. I want to be with him. You can't not have relationships. If you're a heterosexual male, you're going to have to engage with women. And the question is, are you going to do it skillfully or unskillfully? Are you going to go into it with rigid ideas, thinking that all women are gold digging whores, or that they're always out to get me, or that there is intrinsically a power play or a power struggle? Because if you are, then you'll prove it. You can always prove any position. Any person who is an extremist has a philosophy that explains exactly why they are right. And you can always filter for evidence to prove that you're right and delete, distort, and remove anything else that doesn't agree with you. But if you go in with these kinds of attitudes, then you won't be successful. It's the same as in seduction. You have two guys walk into a bar. One of them believes that women go to bars to get free drinks and to validate themselves by being mean to guys. The other guy believes that girls go to bars to get laid. Which one's true? Neither, both, maybe. But if you hold the viewpoint that girls go to bars to get laid, you're gonna walk up to a girl and go, hey there, what's your name? I'm James. And because you're here to get laid, right? Well, I'm here to do that with you. Yeah. Whereas the other guy's gonna be, going up and, say hi, and she's like, hi, no fucking drinks for you, no free drinks. And she's gonna go, whoa, okay, dude. See ya. And he's going, see, I knew it. That's all they want, free drinks. Yep. Positions of perceptual effectiveness is what I'm looking at. What works in terms of having an effect in the world, in terms of seduction? Okay, what works? Being clear works. Being direct works. Expecting that the woman is going to invest in you as much as you invest in her works. Looking her in the eye works. Holding her hand and squeezing gently works. Projecting my sexuality through my eyes works. All that other negative, complicated other shit doesn't work, not in my experience. So gentlemen, please be aware and be careful of the memes and the ideas and the ideologies that you pick up, particularly as you start to unplug. Unplug all sorts of stuff from the social matrix. Question, but don't get paranoid. Question, but don't assign blame simplistically to another group. That's the way governments and kings and powers that be throughout history have managed to manipulate their populations. It's the Jews' fault. It's the Mexican immigrants' fault. It's the women's fault. It's whoever was, over the next hill's fault. No, it's not. It's the guy who's saying it's somebody else's fault. Yeah? It's the corporations. It's the military-industrial complex. It's Monsanto. It's all the motherfuckers at the top who are playing games just to rape the planet, rape the earth, and keep you all in your place. And as you start to unplug, you go, not paying taxes, nope. Dealing with gold and bitcoins, yep. Not being a chivalrous idiot, nope. Not believing what the media says to me, nope. Do all that, that's all good stuff. But be careful about where that then plugs into. Because you can just as easily get hijacked by some extremist group who believes that the Queen is a lizard based on her earlobe. And you can take those theories way too far. I don't think she's a lizard. I think she's a lovely old lady. No. She's all right. This is your only time on the planet. This is a really beautiful and precious and unique time where you have choice to travel, to learn, to grow, to experiment with all types of everything that was ever possible in humanity. And are you going to look back on that time and think, well, at least I said in the, at least I fought for men's rights on the internet. What? Or are you going to look back at, because if the one world government is coming, yeah, and if the lizards are going to plug us all in and pretty soon we're all just going to be tied up in there, having our DNA sucked out, well, we may as well have spent those last precious years of our life traveling, experiencing, exploring, sharing amazing experiences, loving and spreading orgasms all over the place than doing anything that was bitter and hateful, right? Maybe, right? Yeah. My one piece of advice, particularly to young guys, is don't get married and have kids really early. Because it takes a long time for a man to figure out who the fuck he is. I had no idea really until I was in my late 20s. And if I'd gotten involved in a very serious, deeply committed relationship that resulted in children earlier on in my life, I would have fucked my life up. And I would have had a whole bunch of mess. And of course, people do this all the time and they make the best of it. You know, okay, so it happens and they're like, well, I still love my kids and that happened. But if you guys want to, live extraordinary lives where you get to truly explore your own personal masculinity before you settle on anything, then take a lot of time for yourself. And don't listen to the pressures of your parents or your grandmother or of, the woman that you're with or whatever else it is. Allow yourself to grow and to change and experience relationships. Because becoming good at relationships is something you have to practice just as you need to practice approaching girls. It took me 5 long-term relationships to have one where I'm like, yeah, this is really good. It's not gonna cause massive trauma and damage afterwards. It's a really good experience. But allow yourself, because you have this luxury in this time where you don't have to just settle down, get married, and fit into that box of what you're supposed to do. You can choose not to. And lots of people around you, not the feminists, but the status quo, the old school thinking, will often try to pressure you into those boxes, but don't let it. Allow yourself that time to experience truly what you are as a man. And then, in relationship to women, and create a situation where equal rights is something that is negotiated between partners. And then the ideas of submission and dominance are things you get to play out in the bedroom. They're not things that the state dictates to you. Yeah, it's true, women do like to be dominated in the bedroom, often. A very intelligent and powerful woman once said to me, yes, of course, every woman wants to be possessed by one man, if he deserves it. Yeah? That if you are a man who is strong, not tough, who is powerful, but not domineering, then of course a woman wants to be with you and she wants to submit herself to you. She wants to devote herself to you. Because the old school thinking is scared of that, because the men know that they don't really have that power. They need it dictated to women. They need to suppress them and use violence and ideology to hold them down. A real man holds a woman down with his own presence. She wants to be held down by him. She wants to be possessed by him. She's not forced to be. And then you can have a functional and amazing relationship. And I think I'm going to leave it there and open this up to discussion. Thank you.
Awesome. James, we got a few questions for you.
I have a two-part question. So having gone through your journey, you talked about being at ease with yourself. What is the one thing you would have done differently? And then the second part would be, do you have practical tips you tell your clients to find their way faster and not take a decade over it?
Okay. The one thing I would have done differently is I would have been a DJ, not a musician. Would have got way more chicks. Seriously. That, I'm like, think back, my only regrets. I'm like, yep, that's it. No other regrets. The second question was how to do it faster without taking a decade. Practical tips, yeah. In this kind of life hacking industry, there's a real obsession with like faster, better. Faster is better. Yeah, the most efficient and effective way to do a push-up so that you don't waste half a second doing a push-up wrong or something like that, right? Now, I'm all for being effective. I don't think you should like have to go through exactly the same trial and error that me and Sasha had to go through, pounding the beat, doing thousands of hours on the street trying to figure it out, because we figured it out and you can come and ask us. However, it is the process that makes you into a man. Yeah, it's like if you just learn how to do things, it's like you hear about those meditation things that you plug in and suddenly like you're meditating like a Zen monk who's been meditating for 40 years because it adjusts your brainwaves or something. Even if that's true, I doubt it. You've missed the point of meditation. It's not to just like have that instantaneously like hit, here I am in Zen. It's that the process of learning how to have discipline, to watch your mind, to observe the changes in your body, to go through those processes, that's the point of the meditation. That's what develops your character, your resilience, your equanimity, and all of those awesome things. If you can just plug straight into, like, I'm in Zen state, okay, well, that's nice. I mean, you can do that. You can just fucking take LSD. Yeah, like, yep, yeah, okay, I'm Zen. Doesn't really help you as a person when you come out of it, yeah? So enjoy the process. It's not just the outcome of having all the girls. But in terms of, like, practical tips in what area? Like, give me something more specific, because I can tell you practical tips in, you know, posture or, you know, how to dress like a dandy.
Just practical tips and becoming comfortable with yourself. I know a lot of people that go through the process. They find themselves having a lot of hardships, and getting a mentor, for instance, eases that transition, not having so much trauma along the way.
Yes, you do need mentors, but at the same time, be wary of turning a mentor into a god. Yeah, and people try to turn me into God sometimes. Like, people will, like, write to me and say, I'll do anything, I'll be your acolyte for life. I'm like, whoa, dude, I don't want that. I don't want anyone to follow me anywhere for life, please. Yeah, I can act as a mentor to people because I've been somewhere on a path, but I'm always also looking for mentors in my life. The fact is, when you step on the hero's journey, there will be hardship and pain and doubt. That is part of it. The shadow side of this journey is just as important as the achievements or the golden points along the way. What I'd say is it's more important to look at how do you process those periods. Yeah. So the most practical thing I can always suggest to people is to learn meditation, because it allows you to step back into objectivity and watch the way that your ego and your identity and your reactive behaviors inside yourself work. Because it's such an insidious little fucker that will keep trying to put you back into a place of victimhood, of blame, and of like, oh, I'm just this way, or, you know, oh, this, woe is me, I tried so hard, I did 10 approaches and chicks don't like me, and so I hate women, or, you know, I'm a loser, right? So being able to process your process is the most important thing. You know where you want to go, okay, you're looking around, you're looking for models of masculinity or models of success, and you're saying, okay, cool, that guy got a fucking awesome body, or that guy seems really healthy, or that guy's got heaps of girls in his life, and we understand now it's not just because of genetics or not just because he's super cool, it's because he went through a process and learnt it. So yeah, definitely model people, but at the same time, each individual's journey is going to be different, and the demons that you have to face along the way are the things that will pull you off course. It's okay to like go down a path and for it to be difficult and for you to realize it's not the right path, but to be pulled off course for 5 years due to a shitty belief, that's the thing that's stealing your life. Yeah? So I think the most important thing is that. Learn to process your process from an objective position, and also become as clear as you can early on about what you're willing to put up with and what you're willing to give. Yeah, because most people have vast amounts of their life stolen by other people's agendas. Yeah, because they are trying to please somebody else, because they don't want to rock the boat. They're in a position. They're literally living for other people's belief systems or other people's desires. Be really wary of that, and you're going to have to do an inventory of all the people in your life to see where you're bleeding time and energy. Because it's happening. There are people, and people around you are not necessarily doing it out of Machiavellian agendas. They're just doing it because if you let somebody treat you in a certain way, they'll treat you in a certain way. People treat you how you train them to treat you. Yeah. I don't have drama and like insanely bitchy women in my life anymore, because I just don't put up with those kinds of women. I did in the past, because if she was hot and you know, a psychopath, then I'm like, well, that's kind of work. It's kind of worth it. When you get true choice in your life, you realize that, well, there's plenty of hot girls out there who are actually grounded and awesome and are not going to destroy my life. And it's not about like a battle of the sexes. It's about being discerning and choosing what you're going to put up with in life. And showing people that when they step over your boundaries, that you go gently once, I'll do it gently once. I'll be like, that's not cool. I don't do that. And if they do it again, I'll say, see you later. But more often than not, they don't, because people test boundaries all the time, unconsciously or consciously, I test people's boundaries consciously all the time to see how they'll see what how they will respond with me. Yeah? And if I see that someone has clear boundaries, then that's good. It means that I can have a solid relationship. I can have a trade with them. I can work with this person. Yeah, if someone's a pushover and easily manipulated, then I don't want to be around them because I don't want to have people under me who I'm manipulating. Yeah, but people will. There are lots of people who do like that or who just fit into those situations. The things that will, the fast track is not losing your time to stuff that is not going to help you.
So you said at the beginning of your talk that you're not a scholar in sexuality or gender. I sort of am. I actually wrote a thesis on the philosophy of sexuality and gender, and I can tell you that your general idea here is 100% absolutely defensible at the most rigorous logical levels. In fact, there are ethical theorists at the highest rungs of academia that are saying pretty much the same thing that you're saying. The problem is, though, that they don't really talk about what it means to be intimate at a really personal level between sexually different people. And I don't know if that's something that you can answer here today. It's just something that hasn't really been explored in general. And I think it would be really interesting to see you take this idea further, especially with the background that you have and the expertise that you have, and think about what it means to be intimate at a really personal level between the sexes.
Yes, yes, definitely. And that's something that I'm personally investigating all the time. And it's incredibly complicated and messy. The sexuality of two people, whether it's opposite genders or same-sex genders or whatever, is a very, very dynamic and complicated and messy thing because we've got different people's agendas and fears and desires trying to reach some point of compromise. So this is not stuff that's easy to explain, and which is really why I'm trying to warn against making simplistic explanations of anything. Yeah, it's like your personal journey is your personal journey, and an ideology is only going to act as a guiding light. But at the end of the day, you're going to have to, in the bedroom, negotiate this one-on-one with girls. So yeah, it's something that I'm continuing to investigate, and I will continue to speak about because that's my role is to try and help men and women get together in a better way.
Yeah. All right, James, we got two more questions for you.
Thanks for sharing your ideas, James. My question is, you talked about a path, and so I know that you had your own personal path. We all are on our own path. I presume that you went down some roads that you had to go down, but now you've shifted and you've readjusted and made those adjustments to wind up where you're at. Everybody here has an idea of the road they need to go down, and it's not until you start going down that road do you realize you've got to make a course correction. Ultimately, I think we all just want to find more happiness, and we think that this or that will bring that to us. Is there any advice or personal reflection you could give us to help us do that more early in our path, to recognize that that's not going to give us ultimately what it is that we want?
Yeah. Yes, I think, the way I did it was by testing extremes pretty early on. Yeah, and it's dangerous to test extremes because they can break you, but that's what I did. Because rather than kind of live in fear of something, I decided to step into the fear. And yeah, I mean, that meant me getting involved in nihilistic thought about that nothing meant anything. It involved me getting involved with drugs or getting involved with a relationship that was kind of toxic because I was looking to test where the extremes of my human experience were. And I'm glad I did that because it did help me to correct earlier on maybe than some people. And it also gave me an understanding of the darkness as well as the light, which is absolutely imperative as a seduction coach. You need to be able to understand the pain, the frustration, the fear of your clients in order to be able to be effective with them. Otherwise, you're just like a positivity robot who's like, just be natural and fun and cool and just do it. And the guy's like, man, I'm really questioning the existence of everything. I mean, I don't know how to just do it. So yeah, I mean, going through that was really helpful. That's the way I did it, really. I went to whatever extreme, wherever my fear was, I went, okay, I've got to go into that. Yeah, and not so much as smash the fear, but just like move into it and let it envelop me and then dissolve it and step through it and see, okay, that didn't kill me. And that's what I do in seduction. That's what I teach all the time in terms of approaching. That fear exists, it's there. And the simplest way I know to get through it is to step into it and allow it to take me over, but not to take over my thinking. It's like I feel it completely. Yeah, like I feel the physical manifestations of it, because that's what approach anxiety is. It's a physical manifestation of an incorrect idea, which is that women are dangerous. Yeah, and if we latch onto the concept of it, then we get stuck in it. But if we just feel it and observe it, and then this is where meditation comes in, I allow it to just resolve and dissolve, and then I step through, and then I realize, okay, I'm stronger. Yeah, I can move through that. I guess that's what I've done.
All right, last question here really quick.
Okay, thanks for the talk, James. So, real quick, is it possible to go through the personal journey to uncovering your masculinity while being in a long-term relationship, or are they both incompatible?
Okay, very good question. No, they're not incompatible at all. But what I would say is if it happens at the wrong time, then yes, it'll pull you off your path. Because the hero's journey for a man is done... is a solo journey for a lot of it. Yeah, it's something where when you're a young guy and you don't know what you're doing, you're stepping out in to try and figure this out. What often happens is a man starts to step onto his path and he starts to follow his dream and he starts to become more vital. He starts to become more masculine, more attractive, and so women suddenly get attracted to him. And it's very common that in this early stages of your journey that you'll meet a girl that is awesome. Or you like, or is better than any girl you've had before, and then she wants to get in a relationship with you and shut down that journey. It's not that she's trying to necessarily collapse your dream, she just wants to get a hold of you. And it's a very common, I see this with guys, you know, myself and Sasha see this all the time with guys. They come out of a boot camp and they're like charged and they're doing all this cool shit and they're meeting all these girls and then they meet there's a really pretty girl, and then they go, well, just she'll be my girlfriend. And then 6 months later, the chick dumps him because he's lost the vitality and the power of what it was that attracted him in the first place, because he wasn't done yet. His journey was not nearly completed. And there is no completion to the journey, right? I mean, the journey is cyclical. The hero's journey goes throughout a man's life and evolves and changes with time. But certainly in that very first journey where you're really experimenting with your sexuality, your masculinity, your drives, your desires, if you get in a relationship too early and stay there at the expense of your mission, then yeah, it's detrimental. However, when you reach a point where and it's not just a single point, but there will be certain points in your life where you've gone through trials and tribulations in your journey, and you've come out and you're successful and you're powerful and you're at a point of kingship, then yeah, you'll meet a woman who reflects that, who's at the same level, and then being in a relationship with her is the best thing you could possibly do, because that's where you're a mirror to each other. Yeah, where she sees the power in you, you see the power in her, and you exponentially increase that in each other. So no, it's definitely not the case that being in a monogamous or a long-term relationship will destroy your masculinity or your path in life, but the timing of it can, definitely.
Hey, awesome. James, great speech, badass.